As we begin, I'd like to pray the beginning portion of Psalm 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all our iniquities, who heals all our diseases, who redeems our life from destruction, who crowns us with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies our mouth with good things, so that our youth is renewed like the eagles. Church, can we pray wherever you are right now? Can we pray over ourselves, our hearts, as we come to worship as one, all together, but also separately, scattered, but also together with one heart and one purpose? Can we begin with a short word of prayer, just everyone praying and seeking God and blessing his holy name as we begin now? Can we pray? As the world continues through this crisis with the virus, now with more and more countries, more and more people all over the world suffering, God, we cry out to you, we seek you, we come to you. No, we run to you, God, to the words of life, the words of truth, to our only hope and salvation. In the midst of confusion, in the midst of just not knowing what's going on, some of us even wondering whether we are infected or not, with the fear and the guilt of possibly infecting other people. In the midst of all of this, may you be our firm foundation. God, may you be our refuge and stronghold. So we run to you, we shout your name over us, over ourselves. And Lord, I cannot help but think that you have called us, and especially the people here in Korea, as intercessors for the entire world. Even as we have been struggling through this, the more and more people all over the world are now being affected by this virus. Even as we, sometimes somewhat stabilizing. And so Lord, your people, we your people desire to be on our knees, on our feet, on our hands, to lift up the nations to you, O God. We pray for healing. We pray for freedom. We pray for strength, for salvation, O God, for your people, for the world. May we seek you. May we find you. May we know you, O God, through this time. Help us. Help us, Lord. Strengthen us as we come to you, as we run to you, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, let's sing. Let's sing. Let's run to him now. Let's sing with boldness and confidence in our God. He's the one that we run to. Amen. Let's sing.
You are God on the outset, powerful and created. You saw us here before you called all the stars and the earth to existence. You are God, you are holy. History is your story. You was and is and you forever will be. God, we live for your glory. So we will run all together, our hearts aflame with a fire can't be tamed. Our God, oh glory to your name. And we will run our surrender to be you claimed. Our desire that you be praised. Our God, oh glory to your name. Saw us here before you conquered the grave. breathe and to live it on the promise. We will run all together, our hearts aflame with a fire that can be tamed. Our God, oh glory to your name. And we will run, our surrender to bring you fame. Our desire that you be praised. Our God, oh glory to your name. Jesus, to you we love, oh Jesus. Aflame with a fire that can't be tamed. Our God, oh glory to your name. So we will run, our surrender to bring you fame. Our desire that you be praised. Our God, oh glory to your name. So we will run, all together our hearts aflame. With a fire that can be tamed, our God, oh glory to your name. And we will run, our surrender to bring you fame. Our desire that you be praised, our God, oh glory to your name.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, and oh my soul, worship Your holy name. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, and oh my soul, I worship Your holy. Come bless His name with me. And bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. We sing like never, that's right. And oh my soul, worship Your holy.
To sing your song again, whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes.
Bless the Lord,
bless the Lord, oh my soul, and oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before. And oh my soul, I worship Your holy name.
You're rich in love.
You're rich in love. And You're slow to Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart
worship your holy name.
And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, and still my soul will sing your praise unending.
Do you have the confidence, church?
And 10,000 years and there forevermore,
forevermore.
Church,
we sing, we worship with all that is within me. Praise his holy name.
Let's declare our faith and our trust in him now. Let's see.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my day, I want to praise the wonders of your mighty.
Days, and I want to praise the one.
Together before our Almighty God and bow before Him in our hearts and our souls and all our might. Let us confess to the Lord that He is our good God, that He is here in our presence among us as we gather wherever we are, together in truth and spirit, as we bow before Him and offering ourselves as living sacrifice unto His throne. Let us come and praise His name, for He is worthy of our praise and He is worthy of our all who we are. And Father God, we come here today, Lord, in the midst of confusion, in the midst of hardship, in the midst of all things that we're experiencing, Lord, we come rejoicing. We come with praise and thanksgiving on our lips, Lord God, recognizing that You are still sovereign, that You are still our loving Father, who holds us in His hands and who continues to watch over us and who continues to pour His Spirit over us today. Father God, today we commit ourselves to You again, for You have called us out of darkness, Lord, that You have called us out of the bondage of slavery, Lord God, that we may go into the wilderness, Lord, and praise Your name and worship before You, Lord. And so we gather here today, Lord, in one heart, in one spirit, Lord, to praise and glorify You, Lord, today. Father God, we pray for your spirit to be upon all our OEM family, Lord, as we gather, as we kneel, as we come before little screens or wherever we may be, Lord Father, and to hear your voice and to feel your presence here, Lord. This is what we seek and this is what we long for, Lord God. And so, Father, in out of your mercy and out of your love for us, Lord, may you pour your spirit upon all of us here today, Lord. And I pray, Father God, as we just come and sing you, sing the songs to you, Lord Father, that you may be pleased, that you may be glorified in your awesomeness, in your just magnificence, Lord Father. And Father, we ask you, Lord, to remember us, to remember this church, to remember this nation, to remember your creation today, Lord Father. As we sing out, as we pour our heart to you, Lord Father, in this time of suffering, Lord Father, when we do not know the reasons for the things that we experience, Lord Father, but we know that you are a good God who are here with us, Lord Father, and you are seeing through us through all these things, Lord Father. So I pray, Lord, as you have told Joshua, Lord Father, to be strong and of good courage, Lord Father, we seek to your face and we seek and we look upon the cross where our Savior has given himself to us, Lord, to draw that strength and draw that hope, Lord Father God, and to be sustained today, Lord, to be deeply rooted in the truth, Lord, that will surely carry us over. And Father God, as we commit ourselves to today, I pray that you'll be with our little ones. You'll be with all the people who are logging on and looking and joining us here today in this service, Lord Father God. We long to and we long to hear your voice, Lord Father. So I pray, Father God, as Pastor Steve comes up and to proclaim your truth, Lord Father God, I pray for your anointing upon him, Lord God. And I pray the words that you have put in his heart, Lord Father, will be just shining through forth from this place, Father. And to those who hear it, Father, I pray that it'll be a beginning of faith. It'll be beginning of accepting Jesus Christ as a Lord and Savior. It'll be beginning of recommitting their lives to you, Lord Father God. And it will be beginning of being your hands and feet, Lord Father, to carry the good news wherever you have planted them, where you have sent them, Lord Father. And I just pray, Father God, as we just celebrate this Sunday, Lord, I pray that, Lord, that we may celebrate you every day of our lives, Lord, for you have called us into holiness, Lord Father God. And I pray, Father, that our goal is to be holy, Lord Father, sanctified and consecrated for you, Lord. And as we do that, Lord Father God, may your glory shine through us, Lord Father, and may we truly be salt and the light of the world, Lord. And wherever we may be, how little it may be, Lord, cause us to rise and cause us to stretch forth, Lord Father, with your truth and with your love to the neighbors, those who are in need, Lord Father. Let us look unto the people who are suffering, who have less, Lord, and cause us to have the mercy and have the love that you have always had for us, Lord. Father, we confess you are the beginning and the end. And Lord, there is nothing that has been created that has not been created by you. And Lord, you love from the beginning and you will love until the end. And Lord, may we trust and continue to obey. And may we know, Lord Father, whose we are and the fact that, Lord, that your hand is upon us all, that your grace is upon us all, Lord Father God. And you have done your great deed in Jesus Christ and you have saved us through him, Lord Father. So we want to glorify you. We want to commit this time to you, Lord Father God. And we want to enter into your presence at this time and commit this time to you, Lord. And we pray these things, thanking you for everything you have done and everything you have not done, everything that you will do in and through us, Lord Father. And pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Praise God. Today is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We invite you into his presence today. We invoke your presence. Where you are today, and as you have logged on today, why don't you give the Lord a hand clap praise right where you are today? For today is this day, and he has given us life today. This is a day that we need to rise up and say, Lord, you are blessed. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we trust you today. Even in the midst of the coronavirus, we trust you because you are greater and you are better. You are our Lord and Savior, and we thank you. I pray today that as you are with your families today and as you are watching, that God will anoint you and bless you, and that today will be a day, the beginning of a breakthrough in your life today as you come before him, as you watch him, but also as you hear his voice today. God bless you today. Let's go to the word. The word today is being taken from Proverbs chapter 6, verse 6 through 11. That's Proverbs chapter 6, verse 6 through 11. And the title is Sluggish Work for the sermon that we'll hear later. But let's go to the word and see what God has to say to us. Go to the ant, O sluggard. Consider her ways and be wise. Without having any chief officer or ruler, she prepares her bread in summer and gathers her food in harvest. How long will you lie there, O sluggard? When you will arise from your sleep, a little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest, and poverty will come upon you like a robber and want like an armed man. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word. May his word truly bless us today. And let us be praying for Pastor Steve as he comes to deliver the message today, Sluggish Work.
Thank you, Pastor Wes. And then thank you, Justina. And Justina is our youth pastor. And then we want to welcome all of you signing in and then joining us via our YouTube broadcast. And we also want to welcome children, but also our youth group members who are worshiping together with us. I have a few announcements. And then we also have a children's worship available, and especially at our YouTube channel. If you go there, and then you will find our children's worship available. And then I hope that you as a family, as you're able to watch together and prayerfully take time to prepare your hearts, and then watch it, and then do it as an worship unto the Lord. And then as you hear the word, and I hope that you will take time to share together and talk together with your children, and have time to pray together with them. And then also, you know, many of the pastors and then team that's been working hard together, and then they've been receiving many pictures and then video clips of different families, and then joining in the worship together and working on different projects, especially our Lent family projects. And then if you take the picture and video clip and then send it to your directors and then leaders, if you consistently do that, I think there will be some prize encouraging you as a family. But much more than the prize, I hope that you as a family will have a wonderful time of coming together and then worshiping him. This month, our vision offering will go toward helping and then supporting the work that a lot of people are doing, especially in Daegu area, and then helping with and responding to the coronavirus epidemic. If you want to be a part, please go to our website, www.onnuriEnglish.org, and then you can find the bank information and account to which that you can send your money and an offering, and then we will collect it, and then we will send it to them. We want to just take short time to pray together. I hope that you are using this time, utilizing this time, though we cannot come together to worship him, that you will continue to pray for our church, our members, but also for this land and for many others. And I hope that you will take time to pray, and then especially for God's people, that we will be people that will be interceding for this land and for the world. And then and let's go to God and then pray together before we hear the word. All right, let's pray together. Heavenly Father, as we come We come knowing that you are a loving Father. Lord, there are many things that are confusing and many things that are making us afraid. But in the midst of what may seem like a valley of shadow of death, we know it's just a shadow because Jesus has gone through the path that led him to the cross. And because of his death and victory, we know death no longer holds that threat. And Lord, that we come knowing that in the midst of difficulty, that you are with us. Your rod and your staff, they comfort us. You remind us that we are your beloved, that you are with us. And Lord, we pray that you will allow us and then draw us closer to you so that we will experience your presence. And in the midst of difficulty, Lord, we pray that you will again help us to see you, come to know your presence, your love that is real. And Lord, we pray that you will also use us so that we will be people that will speak about you being our true shepherd. And then you, who is able to lead and guide us into the path of righteousness. Lord, we know that your goodness and loving kindness will surely follow us. We pray that you will help us so that we will experience you in the midst of this difficult time. Lord, we pray that as we continue to worship you, in hearing your word, we pray that you will speak to us. Be with your servant as I share the word, that it will be clear. And we pray that you will speak to our hearts, renew, strengthen us. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Sluggish work. And that's what we will be talking about today. A while back, when I was in seminary, a new semester started, and then I met a new friend that came to seminary. I was saying hello to this friend, and then in the midst of talking, I asked him, oh, what brought you to seminary, and how did God lead you to this place? And then he said, oh, I am number 53 from our church. And I was puzzled and said, oh, what do you mean? And he said, you know, the church where he went to and the campus where he and his wife were attending and going to school. And the pastor, at the end of the graduation Sunday, he always preached a sermon from Matthew 25, the parable of talent. And then he always said, you know, God has given you and me talents, 5, 2, 1, I don't know which. But then there will be a day where we will stand before God and we'll give an account to how we lived, how we invested what God has given. And then he is challenging, always been challenging the students and the members there. The reason why I'm here at this campus is because I want to win as many people as possible, so that on the day that I will stand before Jesus, I will bring them and say, Jesus, these are the people that I share your gospel to. But I also want to teach and challenge all of you to become either a pastor or professor at a campus. And because people in their college years, they're so open to the gospel so that you can reach out to them and train them so that they could also become people that will go out and reach out to many others. And so if those people that I trained and then they become pastor or professor and they reach out to other people when I stand before Jesus, and then I think, you know, all those people that are there because of their ministry, and then I may be able to stand before Jesus and say, Jesus, look, you have used me as I serve faithfully. You know, you and me, we are all going to stand before God one day. And then we are going to give an account how you, how I lived our life before him. But whenever I think about this parable, I think about this part. Yes, the person, the servants that were given 5 talents, went out and then put to work. The one that received two talents went out and put to work. But one that received only one talent and then just brought back the talent and was rebuked by Jesus. And Jesus said, "You wicked and lazy servant." And then take him out of my presence. You know, I hope that you and I will not be rebuked by Jesus and saying, "You wicked and lazy servant." As we think about what God has entrusted to you and me, as we think together more about how he wants to use you and me to be a blessing to others. And I hope that we will think about this together. I hope that you will not be a foolish person who will be rebuked by Jesus. But I hope that you and I will grow, and so that we will learn to grow to be more like him. And then from this passage that we will learn to principles that will help us to become not foolish, not sluggish, but more wise as we serve him and work for him together. Now let's think about a few things together. Let's first think about this, that you and I are called to become and learn to become more wise. The verse 6 starts with this. It says, "Go to the end, O you slugger. Consider her ways and be wise." Do you know our God is a worker? And our God is God who created heaven and earth. But in Genesis, we see God, you know, creating men. And then we know that Jesus is also involved in working. And Jesus says, "My Father is working today, and I am also working, you know, today too." And Jesus says, when he went to the cross, "And Father, I have finished the work that you have given to me to do." You see, our God is not about just resting and then making other people do, you know, the things that they don't want to. No, our God is a God who is at work even today. God created you and me to be like him in his image, also to be a worker with him, co-worker, co-creator, and working for him, representing him. In our earlier weeks, we talked about how God has thought about you and then put you here for a purpose, and then how God has gifted you and gave you a calling and reason, and then how God has empowered you with the Holy Spirit, and then how God is raising you up, and then through your life that he's going to bless many, many others. And then he wants to use you to be a blessing. But then, and sometimes what we find is, like the person, the servant that had one talent and then buried it, and we see many people who are idle, and then who are lazy, and then who are not working diligently for the Lord. And sometimes what happens is, and they come to church, and they may be very active at you know, the things at church and serving at church. But then how they live at, you know, Monday through Friday during the weekdays, and sometimes they are not, you know, living out the call that God has given to them. And sometimes we see this disconnect. And they may be growing in the Lord in worship, but how they work during the weekdays many times do not reflect that they really are living their lives honoring and loving and serving the Lord. You know, as we pause and think about some of these things, and we realize that there is an issue. And some of these people that may be passionate in praising God may not be really living it out in their daily lives because they're not wise. You see, wisdom in the Bible, especially in Proverbs, it speaks about skill. And not just knowing a lot about the Bible, but then, you know, having the knowledge of the truth. But also it involves having the insight in the midst of different challenging situations, and then how you are to deal with different issues. but then having the courage to act it out, courage to live it out. So that person who is wise is somebody that's living for the Lord, not just talking, but living for the Lord. You see, the section that we read together, you know, falls in the first part of section in Proverbs, where it's the author is giving an introduction, but encouragement and challenge to seek wisdom, to become wise. And then here, go to the end, and you slugger, consider her ways and learn to be wise. In the beginning of the chapter, it also says, my son, if you put up security for your neighbor, and do it this way and continue to address these people, young people, and to seek wisdom and to grow wise. You see, Proverbs is written for young people, young sons and daughters, young people, teenagers, before they become an adult, for them to consider ways of wisdom, and then also to see the ways of folly and foolishness, and so that they will grow to be wise people. You know, in the book of Proverbs, how can we become wise? And simple reminder and lesson from Proverbs. One passage that speaks about wisdom like this: fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. 1:7. Fear of the Lord is beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is insight. If you and I desire to become wise, according to Proverbs, and you and I need to grow in the fear of the Lord. You see, as we think about the fear of the Lord, we cannot take those two apart, fear and the Lord. And just like as we study butterfly, we cannot think about butter and fly. No, we need to think about the fear of the Lord. Fear of the Lord is connected together with the knowledge of who God is, the revelation of the Lord. As you and I come to know who the Jehovah God, the Lord is, that He is our Creator, and then He is our Redeemer. He is the one through Jesus Christ has entered into a covenant relationship together with you, and He is your loving Father. And then He is the one that will guide your life and then lead your life and desires to use you to be a blessing. As you and I come to the knowledge of Him, you grow in the fear of Him. You see, spiritual response to the knowledge and the revelation of who He is helps you to respond in worship, respond in joy, submission, obedience, and then desire to live for Him. That is such an important basic understanding. You know, but also, and throughout this passage, in the especially Proverbs, the one word that keeps coming up, even in the section that we read, is this, the word path. Sometimes you and I, if you want to be wise, sometimes we think, oh, how do I make a good decision as we try to figure out which college to go to, which job to, you know, take, and then we want to learn how to do things so that we make a good decision, a wise decision. But then Proverbs is teaching us, no, it's not just about making wise decision, but it's you and I learning to walk on the path that God lays before us, in the path that leads to life, in the path of wisdom. As you choose to learn to follow Him on this path, that you will begin to experience more of God and more of His life, and then you will begin to experience how God works and how His ways work as you follow His leading, His truth, and then you will grow as a wise person. This is a very important lesson. Not just looking for, oh, what should I do? No, you come to know him more. Learn to live a life in response to who God is. And then do what he shows you to do. And as you walk with him faithfully, as you diligently follow him, you will become more and more and more like him and more and more and more wise. If we go to New Testament, you know, John 1, in the beginning was the Word, and Word was with God. The Word, the wisdom of God, and who became, you know, for us, became a human being, and we know Jesus is the wisdom of God. Jesus came and said, all you who are weary and heavy laden, come unto me, I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, and then learn from me, and then I will give you peace. And that's what Jesus said. Jesus, you see, is the wisdom. And then Jesus is the one that invites us to walk with him so that we will grow more and more and more in the way of wisdom. So, as you and I seek to become more wise, from the Proverbs, we are reminded, when you grow deeper in understanding, knowledge of who Jesus is, when his love becomes more big and greater, and then when his presence becomes more real in your life, when what he speaks to you and then become more clear through the word, you will become wiser and wiser. And then as you seek to do whatever that he tells you to do, and as you seek to follow him, you will become more wise. And that's what we can learn from here. You know, we will go to the next point, and that is this. We need to also turn away from the wickedness, and then we should not, you and I should not be a slugger, as we see in today's passage. Verse 6, it says, go to the end, O you slugger, and consider her ways and be wise. Without having any chief officer and ruler, she prepares her bread in summer and gathers her food in harvest. How long will you lie there, O slugger? When will you arise from your sleep? A little slumber, little sleep, little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest, and poverty will come upon you like a robber and want like an armed man. You see, as we think about how you and I can become more wise, we should also consider the description about the foolish people. You see, in Proverbs, different words are used to describe who the fools are. And then the word that speaks about mocker. You know, we could go to Psalm 1 and somebody that's mocking the way of God, and definitely a person is a fool. But then, and the word that is used to speak about another kind of fool is, simpleton or gullible or simple people. You see, the word simple ones, naive ones, are considered foolish. You know, they may be young people, because this proverb is addressing to the young people. You know, they may say, oh, I didn't know. You know, that was supposed to, what I was supposed to do. And say, I didn't know the full picture or the consequences. And you see, the Proverbs describes naive, the gullible, as wicked and foolish because they lack wisdom. Because they do not have the clear understanding of the standard of what is true and then what is right. And then they cannot make a right judgment. Or sometimes what's happening is because they are not mature and they are so open-minded to so many different things, and then they're so easily led astray. And then also, yes, oh, I just meant good things, but then they end up making mistakes because folly, foolishness is bound up even in their so-called naivete or innocence unless they come to a point of repenting and being redeemed by God and God's grace. You see, from this passage, we want to look at a few descriptions about these people and consider just the sluggards, lazy people, that in the book of Proverbs consider as people that are full and then wicked. Here, we saw these lazy people are not willing to get up and are from their sleep, and then they don't want to do anything, and that's what we see. In other passages where it speaks about Proverbs 14:23, in all toil there is profit, but mere talk tends only to poverty. Sluggards are the people just refusing to do anything and start something. They have a hard time starting and any responsible work. They're talking, say, yeah, I need to do it. I know that's important. I will do it. They keep coming up with excuses. They keep postponing, but they're not doing anything because they like rest, and then they're good procrastinator. But these sluggards are also people that do not finish. You see, in Proverbs 24, and then it says this, the sluggard does not plow in autumn, and then he will seek harvest and have nothing. You see, it's a harvest season, but then he does not want to go out and do the work. And then later on, when everything is done, he comes out and says, hey, where is my share? Where is my food? And because he hasn't done the work during the harvest, there is nothing for him to eat. And it's interesting, in another Proverbs 19:24, it says, the sluggard buries his hand in the dish and will not even bring it back to his mouth. Picture this. You know, we're eating together with a group of people, and there's food on the table. And then the sluggard, the lazy person, and then reaches out and then takes a spoonful. But he's so lazy, he does not want to do the work, so he is not going to bring the food and then feed his mouth. And he's saying, why am I so hungry? Why am I dying of hunger? No, do the thing that's needed to feed yourself. And that's the humorous picture that this Proverbs is giving. There are so many people say, oh, I'll do it. And then never get around doing it. And because they're not finishing the work, there is no harvest and no fruit to share and enjoy together. But, you know, these slugger people, you know, their issue is not just physical tiredness, but issue is also the issue of the heart. You see, Proverbs 21:25, it says, desire of the slugger kills him, for his hands refuse to labor. And what's interesting here is this. You know, it's the desire of the slugger. They don't want to do anything. But at the same time, it's really killing the person, bothering the person, because they want nice thing done, and they want other people to treat them nicely. You know, they don't want to get up and do the work. But then, like a spoiled brat, and who just expect an excellent quality food and treatment from other people, and then, you know, has such a high expectation from others, but does not want to do anything. What's also interesting here is Proverbs 22:13 said, the slugger says, there is a lion out there, and that's why I cannot go to work today. Because if I go out, I shall be killed. And there's a lion. You know, if I go out, I might get in, you know, in big trouble. Or if I begin to do it, you know, difficult things might come. All kinds of, you know, problems and excuses stemming from, you know, a heart that is not at peace before God. And then a heart perhaps, you know, full of fear. It's an issue of you know, have you ever had goldfish in the, you know, fish tank? And the thing about goldfish is I was told, and then however much food that you give, the goldfish continues to eat. And if you dump the whole, you know, the bottle full, the goldfish continues to eat. And then, you know, because this goldfish does not know how to stop and when to stop and does not have a control. And sometimes that's how we are. When we are so led and controlled by whatever we want to do and appetites and what we desire and do not have the discipline, we can become like this goldfish or the slugger. Couple more interesting verses. Proverbs 26:16. It says, a slugger is wise in his own eyes, then seven who can answer sensibly. Have you heard somebody that's talking like this? You give the person an advice and says, I know what to do. Don't worry about it. And says, I don't think that's the right thing to do. I know. Don't worry. And then everybody else telling them, that's a wrong thing to do. And says, I know. And then so wise. And then even the all the other people objectively telling them and giving them a feedback and say, I know. Say, I know what to do. It's just that I don't want to do it. And sometimes, and that's the case. You know, when I used to teach at a school, and sometimes students, you know, do not come during the office hour, but many of them do come, especially when the grades are given out, and they all complain and then have an issue. Why is it that I'm not getting an A? But sometimes I want to look at them and say, you didn't turn in your paper. You didn't do your job. You didn't do the work. Why is it that you just expect a high return when you haven't done the work? So many times, we're so wise in our own eyes when we are not. That leads to our sluggish, lazy, and foolish work. You know, what's another interesting thing is the verse that we read, a little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of hands to rest, and poverty will come upon you like a robber and want like an armed man. You see, as you are keep living a life as a slugger and then lazy, what's going to happen is you are going to be in trouble because, you know, it's not just you not doing the work, and there is a work that you're supposed to do, and when you're not doing it, it's going to bring about a consequence. You know, there is another passage that uses the very same, you know, the verses, Proverbs 24. And then it speaks about the very same verses, but then it gives you a little bit more picture. It says, I passed by the field of a slugger, by the vineyard of a man lacking sense. Behold, it was all overgrown with thorns. Ground was covered with nettles, and its stone was broken up. Then I saw and considered, and I looked and received instruction. A little sleep, little slumber, little folding of hands to rest, and poverty will come upon you like a robber and want like an armed man. You see, picture this, that you have this field that is yours for you to cultivate. And then this field that is yours happened to be very, very excellent field because it's a vineyard. It has been cared for, and it's a very productive and good field that you received as an inheritance. But because of your laziness, oh, I'll do it tomorrow. Oh, I'll just let it sit for a little longer. And now the thorns are growing, and then the walls are falling down, and then it's just becoming a wasteland. But what's more is this. There is an enemy, moral, spiritual enemy, that do not want you to be productive with your life. So easily, these enemy, the poverty and what, you know, enemy that want you to fail as a people of God and servant of God. And then you see that poverty comes, and this enemy comes to destroy you And because there is no protection, because you don't want anything to do with what's going to help you to become productive. And it becomes such an easy thing for the enemy to come and claim and take it away from you. You know, a field that is very precious, and then what is very, very important and given to you. And if you just put to work and then cultivate, it used to and it will bring about a produce and fruit, and that will be a blessing. If you don't care for, and if you are a slugger, and it will come to a ruin, and it will be destroyed. You know, some of you may be telling me, Pastor Steve, you know how busy I am? I'm not a slugger. You know, I'm so busy doing so many things, I don't even have time. And to do, you know, a lot of other things. Wait a minute. You know, the slugger may not just be the physical slugger, you know, who is sleeping at all time. But you can be a college student, you know, doing all the activities, and then maybe you may be getting a decent grade, but if you are not putting your effort learning and growing as a person intellectually, you may be a slugger too. You know, you may be somebody that's busy at work, putting 70 hours, and then making the money to provide and send your children to school or whatever that may be. But then if you do not pay attention and know, you know, where they are and how they're doing, the needs your spouse and your children have, you may be a slugger, a lazy person that's missing the most, one of the most important things that you need to do. Perhaps, and you are somebody that really is a family man, taking care of your children and doing a lot of things well and then respected by other people. But then in the midst of doing so many different things, if you are not caring for your inner person and then relationship with God, and then you're not growing in the Lord, you are a slugger. You are a fool, because in the midst of your business, you're being distracted from doing what you ought to be doing. We looked at two things. One, seek wisdom. Go to God's word. Come to know him more. And then do what he invites you to do so that you will become more and more and more like him and growing as a wise person. And here, when God's word teaches you, convicts you, turn away, repent. And so that you will be less and less and less like the foolish people. But there is one more thing that we want to look together. Go to the end and to learn. Now, what is this? What is this going to the end and learning? What does and have to teach us? Well, you know, the verses here, it says, go and then consider the way of the end. And then here, without having chief, officer, or ruler. And they're working. You know, one of the interesting thing here is this. You know, the ants, and then they are self-motivated. They're not doing work because they're forced to do it. And then they are diligent, and they're doing the work without supervision. And you and I, we could learn something from here. But then also they say they are working even during the summer for the winter. They know the time. Right now is the time to work, and then they're preparing for what is to come. They have a foresight. But then also, you know, they are, you know, working together to prepare for later, not just, you know, for him, or, you know, them to eat, but to share for a lot of others, you know, for the good of many others. And that's what we can see. They work for the benefit of others. But you know, as we think about this, and there is another mention in the Proverbs, Proverbs 30, 24 to 28 speaks about four little animals and then four little things on earth that are small, but they are exceedingly wise. And that's what, you know, the scripture says and speaks about the ants. Are a people not strong, but they provide their food in the summer. You know, let's think about this. Talking about ants, and then, you know, scripture again says they are exceedingly wise. We, from a Christian perspective, I think we could think about it this way. As you come to know God and study God's word diligently, as you store up God's truth, as you memorize and live according to His ways, day in and day out. The storms will come, winter will come, and difficulties will come. But then you will be prepared. And then you will be helped by God's truth and God's word that you've been living diligently with. You know, the scripture continues to talk about a few other. It talks about the rock badgers. It's a small rock rabbits that live in the midst of a lot of rock pile areas. But interesting thing is, there are small animals that are weak. But then, because they're living in the midst of rock, you know, the clefts and then, you know, the little holes, and even big animals come, they could hide, and then they could be safe. Another thought, you and I may be very weak. We may not have the strength. We may not be able to do a lot of things. But then, reminder about Rock, who is Jesus. As you walk in God's truth and God's word, and understanding, experiencing more about God, who is Rock, on which that you could build your life. Not because of what you can do, but because Jesus is with you, because your life is in His hand. That you are protected, and then you are secure. And that's what we can learn. The locusts have no king, yet all of them march in rank. You see, the locusts, you know, although they do not have a king, and they could come and then and take away and then eat away the whole field. But the thing is, you and I have a king who is King of Kings and who's in charge. As you walk with Him and as you follow Him, He is going to use you to accomplish His purpose. Lizard. You can take them in your hand, but you can find them in King's palace. Lizard, small animal that we find. It says, where did this come from? But, you know, sometimes you don't know what's going on. But then you see them in King's palace. Though you and I may be small and not strong, but we are going to be in King's palace. We are going to be in King of Kings' palace together with Him forever. You see, think about this. Yes, you need to pursue, come to know God more and more and more. Become more like Him in growing in wisdom. You need to turn away from wickedness and stupid folly more and more. But then as you seek wisdom, know the truth, and then learning more insights, but have courage to obey and follow through, and then walk with God. What's going to happen is this, and you will experience God enable you to rise above your limitations, so that though you are small, and then God will help you to grow and become more like Him, and be used of Him to be a blessing where He has placed you. One of the things that I learned about the pet, you know, in a pet store in the States, is among many different animals that you could have, and then a fish, and then you could also have, some people have shark in their fish tank as a pet. You know, some of the shark that you could have in the fish tank at home, fully grown, become 7 inches long. Same shark, when you take it out and put it in the ocean, grows to be 7 feet long. You see, the potential becoming actual. You see, the talents that God has given you, though it may be one talent, if you invest, put to work, be diligent in using it for the Lord, you know what? God could bless it and then use it to multiply and be a blessing. God has a call on your life, has given you gifts, and He wants to use you and me to be a blessing. Don't be a fool. Become wise. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. That you are together with us. As we come to you, that you continue to remind us of who you are, and then invite us to join you in seeking to become more like you, and then also work together with you to be a blessing. Help us not to become a sluggish or fool. Help us to become more like you, so that through our lives, the people around us will come to know your blessing. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
And you unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song, and of deliverance, and from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. Let's sing that again. And you unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song, and of deliverance, and from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. And I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God. And I'm no longer chosen me, and love has called my name, and I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins.
That's why we sing.
And I'm no longer a slave. Child.
I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God,
no longer,
and I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God,
yes I am,
and I'm no
child of God. Yes, I am. You are.
I am a child. With your hand on your heart, your hand on your head, wherever you need, wherever you feel led. I am, yes, I am. You are, we are, yes, yeah. I am a child of the Almighty God, the King of the world. A child of God, yes, you are, you are. I am a child of God.
You know, the beautiful thing about the relationship that we have with the Lord God is that what we did yesterday is yesterday. It's only about what we do today, what we do in this moment as God has spoken through His servant today. It's about what decision, what commitment we make today. We may have made excuses about what we began and never finished. And we may have made excuses about starting and always saying, I'm going to start and maybe never start. We may not have walked the path of wisdom that God has been calling us to. But He's a God of second chances, and today is another chance. I'm going to ask you today to stand where you are as you're watching as a sign of commitment. Or kneel maybe with your family and come together as a sign of commitment. To say what was in the past is the past, but today we're going to move from our foolishness and our folly, and we're going to seek the path of wisdom that God is calling us to. So let's take some time right where you are to seek the wisdom of God, to seek His face right now, because He is our wisdom. Let's go before Him right now and commit ourselves to Him and go before the King of Kings. Father, you said if anyone seeks wisdom, that we should ask you, and you will give it to us generously without finding fault. Father, call us to yourself. Call us to that wisdom, Father, that we may have the fear of the Lord, which is truly the beginning of our knowledge, Father. Not just knowledge of things in this world, but a knowledge of you, Father, a reverential and a holy fear of you, Father, that brings us to a place of looking at things from an eternal significance, Father, and not from any other way, but to see through your eyes, Father. Call us to yourself, that we may begin to walk, O God, as you have called us, as you have placed us, O God. Oh, Father, we reach our hearts out to you today, Father. And our hands that are raised, Father, is just an expression of what's in our heart, Father, that we seek you right now. Father, bless your people right where they are, Father. For we are no longer slaves to fear, Father. You said that you have not given us a spirit of fear, Father. And we will rest on your holy word because it is true, Father. Your word is true, Father. The circumstances of life, the virus of Corona, and the other issues of life do not define us, Father. It's your holy word that defines us in the truth of your word that you have called us to walk in, Father. We bless your holy name. We praise and glorify you, Father, on this day. This day that you have given us life in. This day that you allowed our lips, oh God, to confirm, Father, that we no longer want to walk, oh God, in foolishness, but we want to walk, Father, not only in your holy truth, Father, but in your wisdom. Father, we commit this day and the rest of our lives to you, that you may use us in your sovereign, in your providential way, Father. Whether it's many miles overseas away from our homes, Father, or right here in Seoul where you have placed us, use us, Father, that we might bless those, oh God, that you have died for, and we might declare the truth of your word, that they might come to know you on this day, Father, and many other days, oh Father, that you have given us life. Oh, we bless you, we glorify you, we lift you up, and we exalt your holy, wonderful, glorious name. Let us prepare for the benediction. And now unto him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, and to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, be majesty, be dominion, and be power, both now and forevermore. And the people of God, whose hearts have reached out for wisdom, his people said, amen, amen, amen. We bless you today, and we thank you for coming together as one body in Christ. And as you are with your families, we ask a blessing upon your families. Go in peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Bless you.